Amen. Praise God. Well, you know that I've been using some of the books and resources that I have in my office, and Pete's book of quibs and quotes was used again to start us off and kick us off with a new year kind of thing. One of them that I found was this. It's an American book, so it's full of American things. I don't really want to quote the American stuff, but one of them that I found was this. What a new year brings us will depend a great deal on what we bring to the new year. And that really spoke to me because, you know, as we've said, and I prayed the prayer, and I've read just some stuff yesterday, just seeing what various leaders and church leaders were putting out on their kind of media pages for on their socials for the new year. And one of them that I found was this new year, same God. It's as we go through new years, new seasons, new times, God doesn't change, God remains the same. He is always working for us. And my message I prepared this week, I was only working one day this week because I was on holiday the rest of the weekend. I was in on Wednesday and I had a bit of housekeeping to do, to sort out some stuff and do a few things and get a sermon prepared. And I remembered at the start of kind of December, I picked up my bag for work and it was unusually heavy. It's normally heavy, but it was unusually heavy. And I remembered that I had quite a few books in there and quite a few bits and pieces. And I thought, you know what, as I'm tidying up my office and tidying up, I'll tidy up my bag just for work so I'm ready. And I realised that I was carrying a load of stuff that I didn't need to carry. And it was in that mundane activity that God spoke to me, said, this is your message for New Year. Don't carry into 2022 what you've been carrying around for 2021. Things that you don't need to carry into. And can I encourage you, even in the mundane activities that we do, even in the mundane things that go on, God can speak to us if we're open to hear him speak. Sometimes we wait for God in these grand gestures of our obedience, these grand gestures of our submitting to him, and we think God's going to speak to us there. And 9 times out of 10, he usually does. But sometimes in the mundane activity, if we just have a heart open and ear open to hear what God has to say, God is speaking to us. The question is, are we listening? Are we listening to what God wants us to say? And an encouragement would be for each and every one of us, confirmed this morning, is listen to what God is saying to you this year. Saying, Lord, what are you doing in me this year? What do you want to do in me? Because we can ask him that and he will show us in his word, through him speaking to us with the Holy Spirit, and it will always be backed up in his word what he's trying to say to us, what he wants us to do. And I was clearing out my bag and it was unusually heavy. I mean, it normally is. I've normally got my laptop in there and some other bits and pieces, but I was carrying around so much stuff that I didn't need that was in there. I had my MOT certificate. Why that was in my bag, I'll never know. I had invoices, don't worry, they've all been paid, but I had invoices in there that I thought, where's that gone? I had stuff that I was carrying around, I had books. I've been blessed with quite a few books last year that I need to read this year, and probably buy some more books, but don't tell Lydia, she's not watching, she's not here. But I'll probably buy more books that I'll be reading for the next couple of years. But I had all of this stuff. I had all of this stuff that was carrying me down. It was an extra load, it was an extra weight that I didn't need to carry. And I want us to encourage us. We've all been through 22 months, nearly 2 years worth of lockdown, restrictions, frustrations, flipping when's it going to end, Lord, kind of stuff. And my encouragement is, don't carry some of those things that have weighed us down last year into what we're about to step into this year. Because if we're focusing on the things that are weighing us down, we're not going to have our hands ready to receive what God has for us. Stop carrying the issues from your past into your future. Your future isn't determined by your past, so stop carrying it round with you. 2021 has been a strange year. It's been like 2022, just kind of repeating itself. It's been a year of lockdowns. It's been a year of lockdowns and help out to eat out and then lockdown again. It's been a year of restrictions and restrictions being lifted and possibly more to come in the next couple of days. It's been a year full of testimonies and trials. It's been a year of ups and downs. This year has taken its toll on many of us. Tired, stressed, despondent, weary, anxious. And two scriptures to focus our attention this morning can be found in 1 Peter 5 verse 7 and Psalm 55 22. 1 Peter 5 verse 7 from the NIV says, "Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you." Psalm 55 22 says, "Cast your cares on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken." As we look ahead to a new year with hope and faith, we can't be weighed down by last year's anxieties. You know, David spoke, didn't he, a few weeks ago on Gideon and how we're not to be crippled by fear. Fear is something that we will encounter, but we're not to be crippled by that fear. No, I'm not saying for 1 minute that our circumstances and our situations we find ourselves, we just ignore them, or we bury our heads in the sand and hope that they will just go away. That's not reality. That's not what we're encouraged to do. We're encouraged to go through those tests and those trials, and Jesus is with us always through those things. But these two scriptures encourage me to and give me great instruction. How many times we read the Bible and say, "Lord, what are you trying to say?" Well, these two scriptures are easy. Cast your cares on the Lord. Cast your anxieties on the Lord. You don't need to do a lot of hermeneutics or exegesis to understand what God is trying to say for you there. Great, great instruction is to say, cast your cares on the Lord. I love it when scripture makes it plain and easy to understand. Alan said a few weeks ago that scripture backs up scripture. If you're struggling in a part of the Bible, there's another part of the Bible that will explain it to you. So just dig deeper. Dig a little bit deeper into God's word. Dig a little bit deeper into what God is trying to say. I've started already this year my challenge to read through the Bible, and I want to accomplish it. I have read the Bible through, but I want to really focus my attention and get it done this year, to read through God's word. You know, the podcasts that I've been listening to this year, last year, the two text podcasts, which has been incredible. And if you haven't listened to it, let me encourage you to listen to it, by Dr. John Andrews and David Harvey. Two incredible, gifted teachers in God's word. And John Andrews says this: there's gold on every page of the Bible, every single page of the Bible. But the deeper you dig, the more gold you get. So dig deeper into his word, dig deeper, and the more you'll find that gold. So cast all your anxiety onto him. Do you know, anxiety is the normal body response when we all experience it, and we all experience feelings of anxiety. However, some people find it hard to control their worries. And I love it that we've just said scripture backs up scripture. Jesus spoke a lot about worry. Matthew 6, 25 to 34, he says, "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life." But Jesus, do you know what's going on in my life? Do not worry about your life. What you will eat or drink, or about your body. I love that scripture. What you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow nor reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? And why do you worry about your clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of those. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after these things, but your heavenly Father knows that you need them. That this is the key bit. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. That second scripture that I read from Psalms encourages us to cast our cares, our worries, our issues, our medical concerns, our finances, our family struggles, our addictions, anything that's causing you concern, anything that is bothering you, And the promise is that God will sustain you as we give it to him, as we give those things over to Jesus, that he is our deliverer, he is our provider, he is our source, he's everything that we need is found in Jesus Christ. You know, the Apostle Paul shows us a great example of this. You know, he said in one of his letters, he said, "Be imitators of me as I imitate Christ." But he was sharing about his own issue of weakness, his own issue, and he called it a thorn in his flesh. You just need to read 2 Corinthians 12, 1-8. But in verse 9, he says this, 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9 says, "But he said to me," this was Jesus speaking to Paul, because it's written in red in my Bible. So wherever it's red, that's when Jesus is speaking. Jesus said to Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, and my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore," Paul says, "I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me." This year, let's not be silly. Let's not say, "I don't have any problems, I don't have any issues," because we all have stuff, we're all works in progress. We are justified through faith, but God is sanctifying us every single day. He's making us more like Jesus. Not only will God sustain you in his grace, but it's sufficient for you. He says that, "I'm with you, I'm going to sustain you, I'm there for you." And to be sustained by God is to know that all of your needs, all of those things will be supplied by him. But his grace is also sufficient for us as well. That his grace is there for us, that actually when we do struggle, when we do fall, that his grace is there to pick us up. Not that we use grace as an excuse to continue to sin, not at all, but actually his grace is there. Now I'm not talking about this false humility. I'm asking you to just have an honest conversation with God. A humble, honest, vulnerable conversation with God and say, "Holy Spirit, what area of weakness are you addressing in my life this year?" Because do you know what? If that weakness needs Christ's power to work through it, then let it be done this year. Not that we boast and say, "Do you know what, I'm really struggling with this," because that might be too much for some people. But let's just say, let's be open and honest and say, "Do you know what, I'm struggling in this area." But in that honest conversation with God, Christ's power can start working through that situation. Let's not say, "I've got nothing, there's no issues, I've got no problems." Because that's false humility, that's pride. "I'm all right, Jack. I'm fine." Actually, God is wanting to work in every single area of our lives. Somebody said, I saw lots of people saying, "Why is the food out on the table?" It's part of my sermon analogy, so you can see. You know, we're about to go into a time of prayer and fasting on the 10th of January, and it was during a time of prayer in the middle room a few years ago, probably the first year that I started as the pastor, as I took over from Pete. God challenged me, and he said this thing to me, he said, "Are you who you say who you are?" You know, when you start having that conversation, that dialogue with God, and you want to have that honest, open, vulnerable conversation with God, but you think, I'm all right, God. Just what I just said about, "Are you who you say you are?" I said, "Lord, what are you trying to say?" He said, "Well, are you the storehouse? Are you meeting the needs spiritually, practically, physically, emotionally of the community around you?" And this year is going to look a little bit different. We have food that has been donated to us by Lidl's, and other supermarkets are available, but Lidl's primarily have donated this stuff to us. And within our collaboration with Community Share, we're going to start up a community larder in church so people can come and get food practically. In a couple of weeks, I've got 5 people from church being trained up in level 1 for mental health, for first aid. So when those people come, we've got people in church that they can help and signpost those who are struggling. Because lots of things that you'll see people with, food issues, have mental health issues, have loneliness issues, have anxiety issues, to be able to train people up to help and support. It's just a way that as a church, as a storehouse, we can start living out and being who God's called us to be. I'm believing for God to do some incredible things in 2022. I'm trusting for his leading and his guiding and provision along the way, but we can't be weighed down by last year's baggage. I don't want any of you struggling with issues that Jesus has already won and has victory for over the cross. He defeated every curse of sin. 1 Peter 2:24 says that he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Every hurt, every disappointment, every issue has been dealt with and won by Jesus on the cross. Jesus is our example by the way that he lived and by the way that he ministered into people's lives. Do you know, as we go into our time of prayer and fasting, and I realise by working out on the calendar, I should have done this before, that actually we're doing 22 days, not 21. So bear with us. You know when you put your date in and you count it, you think, oh, that's 22. Why is it 22? And then you kind of read the calendar and said, oh, I've added a day extra.
Thanks, Mum.
Oh, that's all right. Over the next couple of days, you'll get an email with a PDF of what we're going to be praying into. And I'll hopefully try and create just a reminder for us just to go on the page on our social media just to encourage us how to pray. And some of those themes and some of those some of the reasons why we're praying is what we're going to pray. Before we go into that time of prayer and fasting, I'm asking you as your leader for wisdom. Because some of us struggle with medical issues and it's hard for us to fast. Food. This is why I'm asking you to pray and believe that God will speak to you. Some things you might need to fast instead of food. All right, so I don't want none of you to start your 22 days of prayer and fasting, and after 5 days I'm doing multiple hospital visits because you're all in hospital. So for wisdom's sake, pray what God wants you to fast. I remember Jess is here, we did a thing for Lent a couple of years ago, and I know Kezia gave up hot water, and she was, for 40 days, she had cold showers and bits and pieces. So it might be something like that, extreme kind of faith, Lord, make this water hot kind of prayers, but just pray for wisdom, what it might be. Some of it might be social media. Some of it you might want to put your phone away for 22 days and see how God blesses you with that. Be obedient to what the Lord says. It might be food, it might be something else. The themes that are covered have been adapted by Audacious Church's prayer and 21 days of prayer and fasting they did a couple of years ago. I'm not going to take any credit for the work they've already done. I've just adapted it and changed it to fit with our church and the framework that it's produced. But I'm believing for God to do some incredible things during this time of prayer and fasting. And again, it was encouraged by some of the words that David shared and Angela has shared with me about praying these things. And something that God said to me kind of at the end of last year was that I'm fed up of people being sick and tired. I'm sick and tired of people in church being sick and tired. I want God to move into their situations, in their lives. And Jesus said that some of those things only come by prayer and fasting. So as a church, we're going to spend 22 days praying and fasting together. So during that time, it's going to lead us into our prayer of unity, for Christian unity around the churches in Dorchester. And I'm privileged this year to be the chair of Churches Together in Dorchester. There's a form on the back wall there where a number of services are. We have our service on Saturday the 22nd here at 9 a.m, but there's services throughout the week, and there's a joint service on the 23rd on the Sunday at the United Church. Can I encourage you, as part of that, can you be involved as much as you can? Because it blesses other church leaders to see other people come from their churches, but there's different service times. Hopefully you'll be able to get to some of them. I'm not expecting you to be at all of them. But obviously this year is going to look a little bit different in church as well, because soon, probably within the next couple of weeks, we're going to say our goodbyes to Maureen. And please bear with us as we support the family around the funeral plans. I'm going to take in Mark to see the funeral director on Friday to go and sort that out. But obviously it's come to light that the family have very limited funds. And I don't want to embarrass them, I don't want to make a big thing of it, but they don't have a lot. And Maureen deserves a good send-off. So if you feel you'd like to give in any way, to support that, then please speak to Steve. And the church will be giving a contribution as well to the funds. But if you'd like to give in any way, then please speak to Steve and he'll make sure that that goes where it needs to go. I will then invite Matt Lucas, who's a friend of mine, to come and speak to us as a church to help us to plan and prepare that we don't find ourselves in this situation again. That you get the knowledge and the information that you need to know to help you to plan. Because unless Jesus comes in the next couple of years, we're all going to be living. And some of us, like Maureen, are going to go and see Jesus a lot sooner than we will. But that's to help families and plans around that. So please, if you would like to help and support, then please speak to them, Stephen. The church is going to help and support them as best as we can around that. Before I end in prayer, I want to play a song that I heard this week and it blessed me and encouraged me again to look at Jesus and to focus on him. Because before we come and we give him this time of prayer and say, Lord, here's my weaknesses, or Holy Spirit, reveal to me what my weaknesses are. I don't want to carry it into next year and it be something that just weighs me down. Lord, I want you to deal with it. Let's focus on who Jesus is first. Because that reminds us, it helps us to put our faith in him even more. Just coming up now. The words should come across on the screen. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, and everything around. Jesus, 'cause he's the because I listened to that song on Wednesday. I knew I was going to be playing it today. And just as I was listening to it again, rains came, winds blew, but I built my house on you. Last week, last 7 days, I've been up to Portland Bill twice. Once I took Joel for a bit of an explore on Christmas Eve, and he needed to get out and get some fresh air. So I thought, what a better place to put him than the windiest place in Dorset to get him some fresh air. But he was exploring and walking through, and we did our annual up to Portland Bill yesterday as a family to pray and just to give the year to God. And it seems to be busier and busier every year we go now. Everyone has the same idea that we do. It's like, no, this is our thing. And all of a sudden, all these families there at Portland Bill. But we were able to go and pray and as a family, and we went down onto some of the rocks and see the winds and the waves crashing. But even as the wind and the wave were crashing, we were on a firm foundation. We were on a rock that was standing firm. And just those words and just the thought of yesterday as us, as a family, going and giving the year, and it would make you laugh. As we were praying, Lydia and I were both praying, and I prayed out loud and I said, Lord, we do pray for this year. We thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for us as a church. And Ruben was stood next to me. He said, no church. He's like, we're going to go to church straight from praying. No, we're not going to church, mate. We're just praying and giving thanks to God for what he's doing in church. So this year, as we come before the Lord, he won't fail us. He can't fail us. It's not in his nature or his character to do so. So whatever it is that you want him to do to deal with those weaknesses, ask the Holy Spirit. As we pray now, Holy Spirit, would you reveal in our hearts those areas that you need to work Christ's power in, the areas of weakness, Lord, that, Lord, when we are weak, Lord, then you are strong. Lord, I pray, Lord, that we wouldn't be so full of ourselves that we would say there's nothing wrong, but Lord, would you put your hand on that spot and put your finger on that spot, Lord, that needs to be dealt with. Those areas of weaknesses, Lord, where we're weak, Lord, you are strong. Lord, we can trust in you, that you can bring us through in those areas, Lord, because you'll never let us be shaken. You'll sustain us. You're with us. And Lord, your grace is sufficient for us. Lord, as we cast those cares, those burdens, those anxieties, those weaknesses onto you, Lord, you are faithful to deal with them. You're faithful to move. You're faithful to move in this church. Lord, I pray, Lord, as we expand and see what this community larder will bring, and people coming in and people trained up, Lord, to help them with their mental health needs. Lord, I pray, Lord, there will be conversations around you, around how you can bring light into people's darkness, how you can bring hope into a hopeless situation. Lord, we pray for those conversations to take place and lives to be transformed and salvation to spring up from the ground. Lord, we want to believe, Lord, as we pray, Lord, for the next 22 days, Lord, as we're believing for you to do more, Lord, would you do more, Lord, than in this year, Lord, than we could ever think, dream, ask or imagine, for your glory. Lord, we know you'll never let us down, you'll never fail us, because you're faithful through the storm, you're faithful through the trial, you're faithful through the fire. Lord Jesus, you are faithful. Lord, we hold on to you this year. And Lord, we pray, Lord, that we will have pots and jars full of testimonies to give glory and thanks, Lord, at the end of the year for what you've done in our lives. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.